So this is a picture of when I do not really want to chimp, or I do not have time to chimp, or I cannot chimp because the sun is too strong. How did I take this picture? I used auto exposure lock on the brighter side of her cheek. And this area here was correctly exposed. So how do we do that? First, you set your camera measuring mode, light measuring mode, to spot metering. And then what you do is you take your focus point and you place it on the subject that you want to expose properly. You half press the shutter button, and while you have it half pressed, you press the auto exposure lock button. Now, Nikon has assigned it here, but personally, I don't like it there. I've assigned it to the function one button here. So I have my index finger on the shutter button, my middle finger when I'm not driving in Chicago on the FN1 button, which is my exposure lock button. And when I have it on spot metering, I use this. Half press the shutter button, press the auto exposure lock, keep this half pressed, recomposed, take the shot. And this, of course, will depend on the metering spot. Are you measuring the entire scene? Are you measuring the center weighted? Or are you measuring in a single little spot? And you're gonna see it inside your viewfinder. So now, when you use the viewfinder to check your exposure, depending on this little thingy here, this, which shows you the metering mode that you're on. So if you have set this to spot, it's gonna have a little spot, it's gonna show the little spot. And this indicator in the middle, which shows if you're overexposed or underexposed, this here in the middle, it's going to measure according to your spot, to the spot where you have the spot. So many times you have a subject that is completely different light than the rest of the frame. And if you put it in spot metering, this one may show you right zero, you're correct. But if you change and put it into matrix metering, which covers the entire frame, this will show something different. Okay, so from this, you determine the exposure according to where you are metering from. Are you metering from a spot, or are you metering from the entire frame? So in this button, the FN, you can also assign other things like auto exposure and auto focus lock. Auto exposure lock only, which we just covered. Auto exposure lock reset on release, which means after you take the picture, the camera resets the light measurement for that specific point, and you can continue with shooting other things. Auto exposure lock hold, which means the camera will hold the same light measurement for the next shots. Auto focus lock only, and so forth and so on. So this is a case of correct exposure. This is the RAW file, NEF. See that? Correct exposure by using the auto exposure lock. You measure on your subject. Half press the shutter button, press the auto exposure lock button. You can release it and take your picture. You can either recompose or not. It's gonna have the exposure locked in. Okay, but the highlights are blown. Well, yeah, it's mid of the day. Of course, the highlights will be blown by the sun. As a matter of fact, there is nothing better than telling to the viewer this is midday and there was strong searing sun than just letting the highlights be blown. Or you can adjust them in Photoshop afterwards, in Photoshop. Now, one note here. You already know the matrix metering, the center weighted metering, and the spot metering. There is another metering in the Nikon D810 and D850. It's the highlight weighted. The camera assigns greatest weight to highlights. So it protects the highlights. It tells you I will not blow any highlights. Let's see what this does in average landscape pictures. This is what it does. It underexposes everything because it's trying to protect the highlights. Why do they have this metering, you would say? Well, this was designed mostly for wedding pictures of the bride, because you don't want to overexpose the bride's dress, which is white. So you want all the little details and the crevices and all that of the bride dress to be shown, especially in flash photography, and that's where you use it. But in cases like that, no. Look what it does. You know, it protects the highlights in the clouds and underexposes pretty much everything. Finally, and most importantly, go to C1, shutter release button, auto exposure lock, and adjust on burst mode or off in the setting that you want. Finally, the what you see is what you get argument with the viewfinder. I had the A7 R2 for a little more than a week, tested extensively against the D810. And then we had successively for 1.5 years in total, the XT2, the XH1, the XT3, and then for 2 days the Z7. There was not even one picture out of all these mirrorless cameras where the viewfinder image matched the image that I got on my monitor. Not even one. Okay, and the thing is, there was always a rough approximation. Now, the image was accurate according to my monitor when I used the actual little metering device inside the viewfinder, but not the general image. It was not even as good as that of the LCD when I use LiveView. It's a rough approximation because you gotta look at the details. Now, how do you get a correct exposure of this scene, which is in matrix metering, which means it's pretty much an average, so there is not one area that is correctly lit when it's average. Now, in this case, we have an underexposed trunk, but a couple of areas are overexposed. You see that? They're almost overexposed. They're hit by the sun. Okay, now, you can use the auto exposure lock with spot metering, as I said. You set the camera in spot metering, meter somewhere here in the middle, not in the very dark area, somewhere in the middle, okay? And then half press the shutter button, press the auto exposure lock button, release it, fully press the shutter button, and you're fine. There is another, this is going to take you half a second. And the more you practice this, the less time it will take you. There is another rule of thumb, overexposed by 2/3 of a stop in these kind of situations. And you'll get this. The highlights here on the tree trunk are not blown yet. It's only 2/3 of a stop. The rest of the trunk looks just fine now. Looks perfect, as a matter of fact. And the back around, you're going to have a couple of blown areas. Who the hell cares? I like them overblown. They give a certain flair to the image. If you want to tone them down and turn the whole thing into an HDR, high dynamic range image, go ahead in Photoshop and reduce the highlights. What you see is what you get in the intended purpose. So I took this picture and I had the stupid idea of putting a warming filter in front of, and it messed up the entire scene, messed up the exposure. Then I thought, I need this to be darker and I need this to be darker. I need this area to be very darker and the backlight to be sunnier even for dramatic contrast. And I also want more a dreamy background. So I reduced the clarity by 67. In Adobe Camera Raw, and I did other things. I photoshopped the crap out of it and I turned up with this Disneyland cheesy, mission accomplished. This one, the coldest morning in Chicago in the last 40 years, no time to measure, I'm gonna freeze my ass, open window, right? So I put it on matrix metering, let the camera expose itself, and after editing it turned up to this, which when it was printed, it was quite darker here and darker here. So mission accomplished as well. So what do you mean what you see is what you get, when the end result is going to be completely different anyway? Thanks a lot. Bye.